One of the advantages of a state function is that whatever property you are looking at depends only on the initial and the final states. It does not matter how that property got there. So in this screencast, we're going to look in particular at enthalpy, which is our H bar, and that bar signifies that it is specific enthalpy per mole or per kilogram. And so if we have to find the change in enthalpy during a process, we take, all right, here's our enthalpy, and we want to find the change. And so that's equal to the enthalpy of the final state minus the enthalpy of the initial state. But what happens if you don't know these two numbers? That's where this hypothetical process path for state functions works. You can construct this process path where you know all the states in between, you sum them up, and you end up with the delta H, or the change in enthalpy, for the same process. Does that sound complicated? Yes. So let's look at an example. So let's say that we want to find the change in enthalpy of some substance A, and it is a solid at 1 atmosphere and 50 degrees C. So that's its initial state. And we want to know the change in enthalpy for it becoming a vapor, still at 1 atmosphere, but now at 110 degrees C. Now, normally you just take this enthalpy and subtract from it this enthalpy, and there's your delta H. However, what if we don't have either of those enthalpies? So what we do is we construct a hypothetical path where we do know the values, and then add them all up. So this right here is what's known as the true process path. What we're gonna do is take a convoluted path to get from the initial state to the final state and add up all of these enthalpies. So here's what we're going to do. We're gonna start with our solid, and all of this is going to be at 1 atmosphere, so we won't worry about any changes in pressure, and 50 degrees C. And the first thing we're going to do to that is raise it to its melting point. So now we have a solid, which is at its melting point, and now we're going to melt it. And so now it becomes a liquid at its melting point. Then we take this liquid at its melting point, raise it so that it becomes a liquid at its boiling point, vaporize it. So now we have a vapor of A at its boiling point, and then we raise the temperature so we end up with a vapor at 110 degrees C. And so what we do is we calculate this enthalpy, this enthalpy, this enthalpy, then to this enthalpy, which we'll call 4, and this enthalpy. And if we add all of these together, we will get the change in enthalpy for the entire process. So what do we need in order to calculate these enthalpies? So there are two types of heat. When you're doing this enthalpy process, we have what's known as sensible heat, and that's where you take a substance and raise its temperature without changing its phase. And to calculate it, you take a specific heat and you multiply that by the final temperature of that particular process minus the initial. We also have a phase change. And so that's what's known as latent heat. And here it's no calculation. What you do is you look up the heat of melting, or you look up the heat of vaporization. So let's put together some representative values for this particular process and do the calculation. Please note that these are example values and do not correspond to any particular substance. So our heat capacity specific heats are in units of kilojoules per mole degree Celsius. And for the solid, it's going to be 0.15. For the liquid, it's going to be 0.25. And for the vapor, it's going to be 0.1. We also need these phase change latent heats, and they'll be in kilojoules per mole. And so the heat of melting is going to be equal to 10 kilojoules per mole, and that of vaporization is going to be equal to 25 kilojoules per mole. So let's construct a path using these values. We basically have to calculate our H1, H2, H3, H4, and H5. So let's try it out, and we'll put a table together to keep track of our values. Please note that we also need the melting point and boiling point of substance A. So our melting point is equal to 60 degrees C, and our boiling point is equal to 95 degrees C. So here are the different enthalpies that we're going to need to calculate. H1 right here goes from the solid at 50 degrees to the solid at 60 degrees. And if you note, that's sensible heat, so we use the heat capacity. Next, we do the phase change, so that is the heat of melting. And then we have to go from the melting point of 60 degrees to the boiling point of 95 degrees C. Again, this is sensible heat, so we use a heat capacity. Now we vaporize it, and we use the heat of vaporization. And finally, we take our substance A from that boiling point to its final temperature, 110 degrees C, as a vapor. And again, since that's sensible heat, we use our heat capacity. So let's do some of these calculations. So first we'll do our H1, and this is equal to 0.15. And remember, this is in kilojoules per mole degrees C. And that's 60 degrees minus 50 degrees Celsius. And this ends up being 1.5 kilojoules per mole. Now our H2 is just that heat of melting, and that's equal to 10 kilojoules per mole. Our H3, again, is going to be a calculation. It's a sensible heat. And now we use the heat capacity of the liquid. So that's equal to 0.25 kilojoules per mole degree Celsius. And now we multiply it by the difference in temperature from the melting point to the vapor, the melting point to the boiling point, which is 95 degrees C minus 60 degrees C. And that's equal to 8.75 kilojoules per mole. Our H4 is that heat of vaporization. Again, all we have to do is look it up, and that's equal to 25 kilojoules per mole. And finally, the sensible heat of bringing the vapor from its boiling point to the final temperature, and that's equal to 0.1 kilojoules per mole degrees Celsius. And now the difference is 110 degrees C minus 95 degrees C, and that's equal to 1.5 kilojoules per mole. And so when we add up all of these enthalpies, we come up with our change in enthalpy for our process, and that's equal to 46.75 kilojoules per mole. So one thing you might note from this calculation is the significant amount of heat is gotten from the latent heats as opposed to the sensible heat. So whenever you're putting together one of these process paths, you have to be very careful to include that phase change in your calculations.